Hello, boys and girls. Today we're going to do a video that I have wanted to make for a while now. Namely, we're going to code the SHA-2 hash function on an autistically low level, let's say. Namely, we're going to code on a bit level and not going to make any use of basically almost any predefined function, not even, addition, not even logical or stuff like this. So basically, we're going to act as if we were a special, hardware or ASIC, except we're going to implement it in Python. So it's super fast compared to these specialized hardware. And so, just for your information, this is the function that is used in multiple cryptocurrencies in various places. In particular, it's used for mining of proof of work coins. Is there anything else I want to add? Well, yeah, so I spend a lot of time with this function. I have some familiarity with it. I implemented it in various languages. So even if you write it down concisely, you can compactify it and write it on a small level. I will add some general comments, maybe on hash function, maybe on logic, so you get a little bit of a, get familiar with this little beast, with this old friend. So okay. Yeah, well, first, I want to reference some older stuff of me that is very much related. Subscribe to this channel, of course. I did last week a video which is really a preparation for this video. So unless you're the propositional logic expert, I mean, this video got a little bit long, but there are some information there that I'm definitely going to use in this video. You will be able to understand this video without looking at this video first, but there's a lot of information. I talk about complexity, theoretical aspects of SHA-2 and hash functions like it. I talk about logic. I talk about the operations that we're going to define in a minute. If you really, if you want to make a deep dive, then you will have to invest another 1.5 hours. Other than that, I said it in the last video, I have more like by analogy videos on hash functions. And I also, long ago, a year ago or so, I talked about proof of work in a, I guess, layman-friendly way. So this is also essentially about hash functions. I mean, I don't use hash functions there. The by analogy part in this video is that exactly that I don't use hash function. I talk about other work-intensive, computationally intensive tasks there, namely some prime factorization or something. But so this is how, basically, if you really want to know how mining works, why it works beyond what I will say in this video, then check that out. Okay, so much for that. Okay, so I guess we're already there. So, again, in this hash by analogy video that I did with Alexandra, I explain why hash functions are interesting. So if you don't understand it, well, I guess then you're wrong in this video anyway. But if you have seen them before and might be, know a little bit more about them, of course, there are this kind of online tools which do the calculation for you, basically, I suppose. In this website, there's some JavaScript in the background, and here you can do, you type stuff, and this value gets hashed to this value, right? A hash is a fixed length output, and this is here represented as hex values. So hex for hexadecimal, there are like 16 values, 0 to 9, and then A, B, C, D, E, F. And so these are the a sequence of bits, which are, there's underlying zeros and ones. You will see that in detail in this video, and they're like represented here in hexadecimal, so it's a little bit shorter visually. And the feature about SHA-2 or SHA-256 is, of course, that it has 256 bits. So the output, this is 256 bits, and if you express it with more symbols than two, not just zeros and ones, but actually six and different symbols, well, then it looks like that. And here, every value gets mapped to some value. You know, see, if I type more stuff, then I get more values. And naturally, of course, you know, you can compute how many values there are, how many output values there are, namely, you know, if you want to do the math, it's for the first bit, it's two values, then for the second, it's another two values, so in total four, and so on and so forth. So you can quickly see that there are at most 2 to the power of 256 different output values. I mean, that's a big number, but the point is that there are more input values than that, so there's also some overlap. There's a few values, like input values, get mapped to the same output value, so there are some collisions. But the hash function is designed in a way that it should be, like, practically speaking, impossible to find an input two input values which map to the same output value. So, you know, if my input message is just D, then this is the output value. If it's DE, then it's a different value, and so on and so forth. Okay, so in this video, we are going to do the hash function, and there's a small caveat in that, you know, there are infinite input values, and for simplicity, I spare myself one loop, and I restrict myself to chunks. I'm one chunk, basically. I restrict myself to inputs of 55, I think, bytes. So we're going to write a function for inputs of 55 bytes. If you would want to extend it, then you must, like, do a few more lines. So you can compute the general function from that, but for the sake of you know, having the code more nicely and don't, you know, having this overhead, I restricted for that in that video. And since we're doing it on bit level, right, input is nasty. You know, you will not, you either you write a translation function, which is easy to do. In this video, I don't do that. I will just show you that it works based on two values. Namely, I went with hello, and then I changed one bit, and, you know, after O comes P. So we have help with 2L. So I want you to actually memorize the output value for hello. It starts with 2ZF something something, and then ends with 2 2 4. And help, I mean, we can back we can come back to that later. Sorry for that. Okay, so right. So hello starts with 2C. There are some things I will mention, but, you know, the last video was already very theoretical in a way, so I'm just going to pass by these functions. One issue that certainly comes up if you want to, you know something about the security of hash functions is whether or not the ingredients that make for the hash function have certain features. You know, there's a cryptanalysis as a separate subject, and there is, like, you know, a billion of terms. One of those is a balanced Boolean function, which means you have a Boolean function in that it takes binary input values, maybe several variables, and a binary output value, so basically 0 and 1 if you want. And for the thing to be, you know, unpredictable, for making it hard to invert the hash function, right? So let's say I specify I want an output where all of these numbers are A, all of these symbols are A. Then you could ask a question: hey, what is the input value that maps to the hash output value such that all of these values are A's, right? So for this to be hard, it helps if your functions are nasty in a way. And one type of nastiness is this balancedness, which means that the Boolean functions have an even number, or let's say no, the inputs that map to zero are the same as the inputs that map to one in quantity. And if you stack them together, and depending on which balance functions they are, then the likelihood of, you know, basically the entropy, if you want, the likelihood that you can say anything about whether an output at an intermediate computation is zero or one, falls drastically if you know, chain a lot of balance functions together. You might get an impression from that in this video. And, you know, I won't go into detail on some theory here, but it's actually an interesting subject. Like, it's very, like, it's kind of in my opinion, the one of the nicer discrete math parts, subject. And then I will not go into any detail about that, but simply for the fact that I will talk about a function that returns truth. I just want to mention that if we don't do any predicate logic in this video, you know, as I outlined in more detail in the last video, it's just all the propositional logic, like the way we handle our truth values is very simple. This theorem doesn't really apply, because this is actually for some more more expressive logics. But it's a fascinating subject. It's basically, you know, came quickly after Gödel's work. So I'm just giving a shout out, and we'll mention it once we get to this spot in the video. Okay, so again, you know, it's a vast subject. I could show you a million different Wikipedia pages, naturally. But what I want to do here is the following. So just for completeness sake, I will not talk much about the history of the SHA-2 function, but, you know, there's NIST involved, and there's the NSA involved. And there's a family of similar functions like the SHA function, and then there's SHA-1, which is broken in the sense that collisions have been found, and there are algorithms to break it, in a sense, you know, to get two input values which map to the same output value. This description Alexandra actually gave in one of the videos. And what is nice is, here they speak about security, I think. What is nice is that this Wikipedia page has pseudocode, and, you know, we do Python, so this is basically also just pseudocode, except our code will actually run. I will read out basically this algorithm in words, and I will not go into much detail, because we're going to see the details later. And then, let me just check one thing here, just to be sure I'm not shooting myself in the foot. Okay. So let's have a glimpse on that. So this is a pseudocode. This is what we are going to implement. You see, it's not that big. Half of it is some constants. So what we will have is we will have some constants here, right? These are just hexadecimal numbers. We'll get to that. We need these numbers to make it work. So these are some constants. They are termed H. There are like eight of these constants. And then there are a bunch of other constants, which are called K. So this is an array of 64 numbers. And, you know, there's actually, I'm not sure if they describe it here, but these numbers are obtained by, you know, they said, you know, let's take the square root of something and then look at the digits, and whatever is there should be more or less random. So let's take that. That's the argument anyway. And then is here is how what you have to do with an input message. So again, in our case here, for example, hello would be the input message. This is in some ASCII characters, right? H is not among the first 16, it's not among the symbols used in hex. So you know that, as I discuss in the last video, I think also, you take some bytes, which are 8 bits, so 2 to the power of 8. You can here's my terminal, Python, 2 to the power of 8. So it makes for 256 ASCII characters, and so these are among them. You know, I demonstrated in the last video how you get to this. I mean, I can do it here again. 4k in range, 2 to the power of 8, print, and then I think character k. Yeah, right. So these are all the characters. The characters that cannot be displayed, okay, but yeah, so let's see if let's do this again, but annotate which numbers they are. So we see, for example, that the letter H is the 104th character, and so if you want the binary representations of 204, then we would say, you know, that the sequence of 8 bits, 1101000, this is the H character. So in that sense, you know, this is 8 bits, this is 8 bits, this is 8 bits, this is 8 bits, this is 8 bits. So these are, oops, so these are 5 times 8 bits. So 5 times 8, so these are 40 bits, right? There's an input of 40 bits. So this is the length in bits, and the length in bytes would be 5. Okay, so what do we have to do with this message if we want to give it as an input to the hash function? Okay, begin with the original message of length L bits, so L would be 40 in this case. Append a single one, so you know, you take this sequence of bits, then at the end you add one more, so we are now at 41 bits. Then append a bunch of zeros, right? 0 bits. And then the number of zeros, they must match a certain size, because this is the input size of the algorithm. So this number of zeros that you have to append is the minimum number such that this equation is a multiple of 212. So let's say, no, 40, 41, and then plus some variable, plus 64. So that means we are at 105 plus k must be a multiple of 512. So if I'm not mistaken somewhere in my calculation, which might be, then we will just have to add, you know, so and so many hundreds of bits that we are arrive at 212. And you know, and if my input is already more than you know, so and so many bits, then naturally you add them such that it's 2 times 512 or 3 times whatever it is, right? And this is also the reason why in this video I will not do this arithmetic of, you know, multiplying blah blah blah. So that's why I will restrict myself to this certain number of bytes, so that this is just a simple time, like one time 212. Okay, and append L, the number of input message bits, as an 46 bit endian integer. So this number would be 40 in this case, and you take this number. This is endian, means like how you represent the array, whether or not to read from left to right and blah, blah, blah. So this big NNS, this is just, you know, optimization on a bit level that's not very interesting. And it's represented in some way. And then this number gets represented also as a sequence of zeros and ones, and then added, yeah, making the total post length a multiple of this again. So you will see how that plays out for our example. But basically, you take the input message represented as a sequence of zeros and ones, and then there's some strict rule on how you have to squeeze it into a bunch of arrays so that is a valid input for the hash function, because the hash function is a, you know, deterministic object that wants a certain input, and whatever your input is, you have to pad it from left and right, in this case only from right, but with some zeros and ones. Okay, and then process this message in successive 212 bit chunks, and in our case it will only be one chunk. So we will go through these chunks. This is only one chunk in our case, and we have, you know, we already had this constants h and k, and we are going to have a an array w where we drop in our message, and the rest is, you know, zeros and ones and blah blah blah, and then we're going to use this as a working variable to write on it. We obscure this kind of object. Previously we dumped a bunch of zeros, and then we're going to write stuff to it, and this is the algorithm how we write stuff to it. We will see that how that looks. And then we have a bunch of more variables a to h. These are just some values that get used and then rewritten all the time. And what this says is we start out with the constant that we had above, and then comes the main body part of the thing. You know, you have this w, you have this big array of values, and then where does it enter? So there must be the W entering somewhere. I just don't see it at the moment. Ah, here it is. So there is some very nasty for loop going on. It goes to 64 iterations, and all these random looking basically numbers, they in certain operations get mixed up, and at every stage we are going to throw this W into it, which consists basically of our input, and this goes on and goes on and goes on. We're going to code that, and then in the end there's one last step where you again evaluate this constant, these h's, you overwrite them, and you know, all of these values have somewhere in between the input message, you know, mix in between, and then you get to the final values, and then you add it up, and what you get is the output. So this here, this 8 values here, these are these things, you know, if you cut them into 8, so there's zero, H0, H1, H2, H3, and so on and so forth. Okay, so much for this basically short overview, and now we're actually going to get into it, shall we? Okay, so my X is not really working, I don't know why. So let's get out of this. So, okay. Here, I already have, you know, it's my cheat sheet. I already coded it up in Python. But we're going to code it live, of course. But this is just so that in the case that I'd make a mistake, and I don't know, it might be likely that we can come back to that. I give you a glimpse of how it looks. So, you know, this is truth values. This is I'm going to describe this in a moment, right, in much more detail, but truth values, this W, this H constants, this K constants, and then some logical functions, some array functions, and we're going to need addition of numbers, which we're going to code ourselves. Then this is just some utility function. And then this is the algorithm, right? It was in two parts. This was this the W stuff. This was the main part. And then we're going to return the value for our input. And just so you see that it works, I'm going to do Python. And what's the name of this? SHA-2. .py. And you see this output pops up. This is the result of this computation. Upon this input value, I'm going to describe it in a moment. And actually, if you want to change the input value and take this value instead, then I change the hello to help. And so if we evaluate it here, then we get that. And if you look back, then hello started with 2C and help started with FD. So this is exactly what we have here. So hello, 2C, help, FD. Okay. So I hope you're convinced already that this works. And now we're going to get into the details of this object. Okay, so that's just one thing. Of course, you know, I'm not going to type these fucking letters like these are basically my zeros and ones, right? So these are the numbers, and if you allow me, I will actually steal those. I will not actually write them down manually, but I will give me a head start and go in here. So this is the file I'm going to write in, SHA-2 live. If we execute it now, Python SHA-2 live, then it says hello world. This is just this, but we're going to delete that now. Come on. So, and dump this information here. Okay. So let's start. Okay, so as I said, right, we're going to do this basically on a Boolean logic level, on a propositional logic level, if you want. So I'm not even going to use zeros and ones, right? The Boolean logic is the representation or semantics, if you want, of propositional logic. And I'm being even more, how do I say, elitist about that, or like purist. So I code in a way that this is abstracted away from that. Basically, if you would have an ASIC or some specialized hardware, then all these values would be represented by some bits, and you know, over the decades, bits were always represented by something different. Okay, this is not really about hardware, but here we have just some abstract thing. And what we're going to do is we introduce some constants, which are these two values, right? We're going to introduce our truth values. This is basically our, this is a comment, right? This is our zero, this is our one, and we're going to give it some value. And I will code it in such a generic way that it really does not matter what this value is. The only thing that matters is that I can check that these two values are different. This is the only requirement I have from this. So this is some value, let's say it's, I don't know, hashtag type theory. Because why not? And this is, you know, it's life. So these are just two values. It doesn't matter what they are. Like here, I used some value and a different value, right? I have even some information there. Okay. So we have truth values. So far, so good. And now, I'm going to go to these arrays, right? So these arrays are of a certain size, like this h and this k. This is what we had as constants here. Like if we go back to the Wikipedia page, these values and these values. And if I annotated it in the script already. If I take this value, right, this is a hexadecimal representation, 6A09E667. And if I go in Python, and I do a binary representation of this number, then I get this thing. And if you were to compare with that here, so you cannot see it. Let me squeeze that together. So from right to left here, 1 1 1 0 0 1 1 0 0. This is exactly this here, like one truth one. This is all, you know, this one value. T T T F F T T F F. This is exactly that. And if we look from the right side, then there's a zero here on the right hand side that is not shown, because, you know, if you use it as a number, then it, the trailing zeros from the left are don't matter. But apart from that, it is 1101. This is this 1101, and so on and so forth. So you can see that these are indeed just the these values. And that's actually how I got them, right? I didn't type them like TFFFT and so on and so forth. I just wrote a very short script that took all these constants in hexadecimal value and printed them as this kind of, you know, string representations of F and T, and that's how I got this arrays. And so we have 8. This is basically a number, right? So this array of zeros and ones, this is this number. And same is also for the k values. The only difference is that they are arbitrarily, if you want, grouped together. And these are 8 numbers, and these are 64 numbers, right? This is a number. And that's how they are like squeezed together. And the W as well is a bunch of numbers. Namely, it's also like you initialize it as 64 numbers. Here in Python, I initialize it in Python as all zeros, right? So 32 times f, this will give you an array of a bunch of f's. You know, I can show you this here. So if you go I use strings here because f doesn't have a value yet in my Python script. For anything in range 32, then I get an array of 32 f's, right? So this is an array of zeros. This is basically number zero, and I actually want 64 of these zeros. So this is the initial array that we are going to work with. And now into this array, the rule is to dump our message. And so I'm not 100% sure if this will work out, but let me just test something. So what did we say? Binary of 104. Not sure if that makes sense right away. You're right. Okay, so you know, I had shown you that the H is the number 104. I've argued that with this ASCII values. And now in binary, the value of this H, it looks like that. And this is exactly what I dump here. So you see this number, like this number as the array represents a tensor number. And if you split it up into bytes, which have length 8, then you can squeeze 4 characters into it, right? So by that logic, these are the letters hell and these are the O, right? These are the O, right? In this case, it's P because let's go with hell low. So this is the O, right? And this is how I dumped the message into the beginning of this W. And then the rule was, if you remember, to add a one after the message. Well, I will show you to get you on the same board as me. So begin with the original message of 8 bits. So in our case, 5 times 8. And append a single 1 bit. So this is this bit. And this is basically, you can say from the later, from when we digest this input, right? then this is basically saying, oh, the point where the one, there's a one and the rest are zeros, like the, after that is a bunch of zeros, in the, at least in this word, and afterwards comes different things. This is basically where the message ends, right? So if I would have chosen the word hellfish, I don't know, then all these eight times eight bits would be filled with some representation of an SC character, and the trailing one would be in the third column, right? If this was a longer message, then this one would go a little bit down the road. And as you can see here, everything here is zeros afterwards. Like, you know, I set a value to zero, I set a value to one, and then all the values from 2 to 14 are zeros. And then if you follow the rule laid out here, then at one point, you know, if you do the math, then it comes one spot where you run out of places, right? Out of scope for this chunk anyway. And then you have to append the length of the message as information in the same W array. So what we have here is basically just the message. And I don't remember that, but I even prepared this information here. So if you check out the binary representation of the number 40, which is the length of the message in bits, then we get 101 and then a bunch of zeros. And this is exactly that, right? So this is then this Indian representation of the message. And among other things, this also means that, like, if you were to change the message to some other message, to some other message length, like if we add one letter here somewhere, then this value would also change, and we can only control this value, like, from a, let's say, hacker perspective. We can only if we move in between one fixed length, then we have this as a static thing. If this becomes a dynamic thing because we change the length, then the hash function will notice this change and return a different value. And of course, a good hash function is such that if you return one input value, then the chance of the output value for every bit to be flipped should be one half, right? So it will, I hope I say that correctly. There's actually the formalization of what a good hash function means. Let's hash the criteria, cascading, let me think, hash cascade, cryptographic hash function. Well, you have some formal. Yeah, I don't know. The funny thing is, there's a cryptographic hash function. There's actually also the hash function article. So, you know, it's a broad topic if changing that. Like, what is the, you might want to ask, what is the cryptographic hash function? Not a hash function, it's not, but it's basically about mathematical properties, probability, use, and so on. Okay, sorry, I am digressing. Okay, sorry for this lengthy explanation on how the setting of the value works, but really this is just what happens under the hood if you plug in your input to any hash function. So we have those set, right? These are the numbers, and now comes the nitty-gritty part, right? So, okay, first what we're going to do is, we're going to write a true function. We say, I will just write a function which, for some part, you know, I use these general values, and sometimes in the end I want to, the nasty thing is really that in the end I want to show you the output in hexadecimal, and for this reason and some others I eventually have to write some convenience functions, as you saw, that will translate these arrays that I work with back to hexadecimal and binary and so on and so forth. So eventually I will write a couple of these helper functions, and one of them is the function which essentially maps our truth values to the Python inbuilt truth values, right? So this is Python, and the truth value true in Python is just true, for example. And if I say, you know, true or false, which is the other value, this is true and true and false. These are connectives. These are the truth values, and basically this is Python also treats these truth values as one and zero. Basically, it's derived like from C, the C programming language, where all these kind of notions fall together. So if you do actually, I don't know, 3 times true, I think it gives you 3 exactly, because it is just interprets as a 1 in this case, right? And so we will make use of that. So I write a function true, and I write them all these functions in capital letters simply because we're going to define an end on the function, and they are already inbuilt functions in Python, which mean the same thing more or less. So that's why the capital letters. Okay, so our true function will work like this. Yeah, my x doesn't work. This is nasty because I plan on using x a lot. So what will this return? Well, it should return the Python true value if the input value is true. So if x is true, that returns true, right? So we make return x is true, that our you know, custom truth value. Okay, so far so good, right? So then basically, you know, this also refers back to what I said in the last video, where I made the case how you can, you know, break down all the Boolean functions back to Sheffer strokes or NAND gates and AND functions and so on and so forth. In this video, we are going to basically use one primitive, if you want. I mean, we are going to use truth values. That's already, from a logic perspective, a kind of big case, because there are indeed, you know, depending on what logic you know, this is goes in the type theory direction, but you might not necessarily need to define truth values or as constants in your logic and so on and so forth. But we do this in this case. And we're going to also define our custom if function. And it goes like this. So there's already an if function in Python, right? But the problem is that it doesn't behave as a function in that sense, that you can pass 3 arguments, and that's what I want to do here. So I want to write a function that says the following. If the value passed as x is true, then return the value y, and all the values that we were going to return will be Booleans. This will either be effectively either be t or f. And if x is false, then return z, right? So how does it work here? Well, so what I did here on my cheat sheet is I called them a and b, and just to not confuse myself, I will just take these variable names. So we're going to return a if, and now we need a true value, right? So we say true of x else b, right? So this is our true function, right? X is t, this is the same thing, right? So this, we could write this, but let's use the function we just defined. So if x is true, then this will be the Boolean truth value, because this returns that. So a will be returned, the first value. Otherwise, the second value will be returned. Okay, we will define a negation function, not x. And this will return, well, we can define it in terms of the if function now. If x is true, right, then we want to return f, right? If x is true, then the opposite of true is false, so we return false. Otherwise, return true, right? That's it. So now we have to find the not as a in terms of another primitive, you know, just if and t. We are going to define the XOR function. Jesus Christ, XOR. So what is the XOR function? Well, it checks if the two Boolean input values are not the same, right? It returns true if the input value is not the same. So how do we do that? Well, if X is true, if X is the truth value, then, okay, I will write it down. Return not Y. Why does this make sense? Well, you know, say X is true and Y is also true, then they are not different, right? So then the return value of the XOR function, because the values are not input values are not different, should be false. And how do we get false out of two true values? Well, we have just to negate one, right? So, and if X is false, well, then it's the other way around, right? So if X is false, then for this to be true, Y has to be true. And if Y is true, we can just return Y. And the other way around, if X is true and if X is false and Y is also false, then that means they are the same, which means we have to return false, which means we can return Y. So you see how that goes, right? Okay, here's a more interesting one, because it's a Boolean function of more than two values. So it's not one of the typical connectives you'd see. So this is the majority function, which takes an important role in the SHA function. So three Boolean values, we return something. What is it? Well, the majority function looks at three Boolean values and just returns the value that pops up the most cases. So if two or more of the Boolean functions agree, and this will always be the same the case, then return that value. Like, for example, if all of them are false, then you have to return false because they agree on being false. If one of them is true and the other false, well, there are still two that are false, so we have to return false. If two of them are true, you know, you get the spiel. Just a majority opinion, if you want. It's a vote. It's a, you know, if you study voting systems, as I have done a lot in the last year, then this simple, you know, decision rule will also pop up. You know, you can generalize this in various ways. But here's just the implementation for tree values. So how do we do that? Well, this is actually simple. It's longer than the other ones, but it's in my opinion simpler to you know, follow. So if X is true, let's say, right, then there's only one more values that we need, right? You have to check, of course, all like at least two. So if X is already true, then the second entry, this one, will be returned. Well, if Y is also true, then this is true, this is true, the majority is already true, because these two values have already agreed that two is going to be the result. Well, then you return true. So you can write T, or you can return Y, right? So, because, you know, this is true, this is true, okay, Y is true, so we can return this. This will be the return value of that, and this will be the return value of that. So true is the return value. But if X is true and Y is false, right, then we have, you know, they are like, is it true or false? 50-50. So the last value decides. If Z is true, then return true. If Z is false, then return false. So obviously it's Z, right? So for example, if X is true and Y, then we go into this branch. There's another branch later. If X is true, then check Y. If Y is also, it's not true, then Z has the deciding hand. And so we return the value of Z because it's the deciding one. And the other clause is basically, you know, it's this the symmetric thing. You know, if X is false, then if Y is true, then Z must decide. Otherwise, if X is false and Y is false, well, then the return value is false, so we can return Y. You know, we can also do like this and so on and so forth. But to not overuse the truth value and be more elegant if you want, then I will go with this way of writing it down. Okay, and then there's one last, we are already finished with that shit. There's one last thing, and this is the XOR XOR. Basically, this is like another check that is just using the XOR function twice, right? So it's a free, and it's literally just defined as XOR XOR. Return XOR XOR. So what is it? So, and in this case, you know, we can also, on my cheat sheet, I did it like that, actually. It doesn't matter because it's symmetric in that sense, but so. Okay, so these are Boolean functions. Maybe I should test them, but I will not right now. Let's see if I make it work without error through the end, but okay. So the next thing we need is we're going to apply this Boolean function. You know, these Boolean functions, they will be called literally millions of times, I think. Or at least 50,000 times in one hash function computation. But we're going to work with arrays, as you see here, right? So we are going to define functions that are the versions of these functions except for arrays, right? So we're going to define an if function. This is if xy and return. And so what that does is like component-wise, like we got x now is going to be an array like this one, right? And y is also going to be an array. And what we're going to do is we're going to apply the operation component-wise. So we say, hey, or in this case, we need three actually. So apply it to t, t, and t. The if function on t, t, and t would be t, the return value, right? If this is true, return that value. If this is true, which is not, to return the other value, which is t, and so on and so forth. So this is the component-wise return value. And this is very simple. We just say if the function that we already defined, and I'm going to call it variables xi. So this is the ith, you know, if we have a running index from 0 to 31 or from, you know, 1 to 32 in this number, I will just call this xi. And we need three values. So yi, zy. And we are going to apply this for, and then these values. This is, you know, nice Pythonic way of doing for loops for all these values in, and then we're going to use a Python function zip. So what this does is it zips these together, right? It makes a matrix of these arrays, like that would be 3 times 32 numbers. So whatever x x, y, and z is, it's going to be 96 bits, and it reads out them in sequence, these three, and so on and so forth, and applies the if function like component wise, and then creates a new array. This is the array brackets around this thing, and returns that, right? So we have this array wise Boolean function. Okay, then AND function. Well, it's the same spiel, right? You know, if I would not be like, if it could be bothered editing, then I would just fast forward for 2 minutes. But, you know, I will just comment this from, copy that from there, right? So this is that. This is just the array-wise application of all these. And in my cheat sheet, it was a fancy to make that arguably more readable by going like this. Okay, so and in reality, simply for the sake of making sure that it works at the end, I will take this block and copy it over there and replace my old one, just because I don't have unit tests. Ah, it looks like it was the same. Okay. We need three more functions, which are arguably a little bit more interesting. We're going to use write rotation, which makes the hash function also more complicated. You know, the intention of most of these things is to make the output less predictable. So it's like very ill-spirited thing to do. Return. And in Python, there's a very neat implementation of that, and I will just code it and only then tell you what it does. Or show you, actually, in this case. So x will be this array of bits, right? And n is any function, any number. Like in our case, it should not exceed 32. But it's some number. And what we're going to do is we're going to right rotate our array, which means effectively we're going to take n numbers on one side, cut it out, shift everything to the left or right, I don't remember, and put the things we cut out on the other end. So I can actually show you that in practice, because it's such a nice small function. I'm here already in Python, I can define it here. So it's defined. And what we do now is we say, okay, let x be the list of all numbers to 10, right? So x is this array of numbers. And if you apply now, for example, the rotate right, the right rotation, with, let's say, three elements, then what you see what happens. These three numbers on the right are taken, and all seven numbers here are shifted to the right, and this end is appended at the beginning. So this is that what it does. And this function will be used to screw us, to skew which numbers are going to be paired with which numbers. We have all these component-wise operations here, right? So if we only apply all operations like this, vertically, so to speak, then all these arrays would be independent of each other. But if you like mix them up, then it's one way of getting some sort of non-linearity in it, if you want. And then we have a similar function, which I call cut here. Also takes the same input values. And what this does is a little bit simpler. It cuts off bits on the left and pads it with zeros. So how is this implemented? Well, we say we want n f's, right? So, but you can do that in Python, you know, if you take a number and multiply it with an array, let's say this has f or anything, fun. Then you get an array which is like just three times this number. So there is some arithmetic tools in Python. So this is how it will start, right? We pad from the left with f's, and then we take x, but we want to cut something. And so this is always slicing in Python. And what we're going to do here is, how many of these x's do we want to remain? Well, it depends on the length of x, and which in our case will actually be fixed, but we can write here the length of x and then minus how many we cut. So we can do like this, right? Okay, let's test that. So if we cut from x, let's say 6. Of course. F is not defined here. So because here this is the scripting environment, right? So I do go with exclamation mark. This is the definition. And so if we cut 6, then these are set to the word ha. And in our case, we're going to set them to the Boolean value 0 or false or f. Okay, so far so good. Now comes the interesting one. I hope we are not too bored till now, but here comes the addition. I call this add function. This is literally just the binary implementation of addition, right? So how does addition work? Do you know? How does addition work if you use binary values? Well, it works actually exactly like decimal values. It even is simpler, right? There's actually much more concisive implementations, because there are not so many values that you have to take care of. So what do we do? Well, we start. So there will be a return value of this add function. I call it z, x, y, z. And then, okay, well, let's make a short breakdown here. Okay, so if I have this number, right, which represents 1 plus 0 plus 4, so this is should be 5, int 5, yeah? And if you have, let's say, this number, which is, and let's make it more complicated, this number, which should be 1 plus 2 is 3 plus 0 plus 8, if I'm not confused. Is it 12? Let's check. Int. What the fuck did I do here? Sorry. Int 5 doesn't make... Sorry. That was stupid. So, I have to do it like this, of course. Sorry. Int... Okay. So, what was going in this direction? Python again. Give me 1 second. Well... the sad thing is I forgot how to go from binary to decimal, but so I'm going to skip that because I don't want to look it up yet just now. I think I have to put the B on the outside. Is that possible? Yes. No, that's not right. Okay. So in any case, I'm pretty sure this is 5, and accordingly this is 8. So if you add them together, right? If you add you have this number in binary and you have this number, well, you add the ones, which gives you 1 and 1 is 2, and then, you know, mod 2 is 0, and then 1 carry over, and I want to emphasize this carry over, right? So if you do this, then what you get is from the right to the left 0, and then this 1 carry over, then 0 plus 0, and then this 1 carry the 0, the, like this one, no, wait a minute. So this one, and so it should actually be this. And if I didn't talk bullshit, then it should be 5 plus 12, which should be 17. And this is, nah, I don't know, you know. I actually talked about this in the last video, and I don't want to look too stupid, so I will scratch that. But you can imagine, you know how binary addition works, right? So you add the numbers together, and when they are the same, then the result is 0. And if they were ones, both ones, then you get a carryover, right, value. So what we're going to need is this carryover. And so the return value is going to be a list of length 32, a list of range 32, and the carryover value, let's start with f, right? From the very right comes nothing. Okay, so this is also a Pythonic way of, like, I'm going to use this a bit. This is the same as defining them like so. Right, this is the same as defining this in two lines, except it's a little bit more concise. What do we do? Well, we go from the right to the left. We go all through the array, right? So we go with 4, then index, in, range, and then we go 32. But okay, we have to start at the right, like, you know, we could not flip all the arrays and then start, do a normal for loop. That would be one way of doing it. What I want to do here is I will just instruct Python to start on the other end. So how you do that is, well, first things first, we actually want to go from the... So the you know, this is one off thing, the 32th element. This is the length of the array, but the index is actually 31, so we have to subtract 1 here. We also have to start on the right, and so we, in this case, we need to to have this one off, minus one again. And then the third argument for the range in Python is that you go in the other direction. So you go from, you don't wander from left to right, but from right to left. Okay, so this is our for loop. And what will happen? Well, we will going to update our set value on the ith position, and we're going to update our carryover, right? And for purification's sake, I'm also going to go with this notation again. So how does it work? Well, as I just said, if the values are the same, then you have to place a zero. If they are not the same, then you have to place one, right? But actually you don't just add all the numbers together, but there might or might not be a carryover. So you actually have to take three numbers into consideration, add them up, and see what the result is, right? And so how does it work? Well, we already have a function to see if there, like, who does exactly that, checks exactly whether, like, the result of two functions is if the input of two functions are not the same, and returns one or true in this case. So we need the XOR function, and we actually need it twice. And so we can use XOR. Ta-da. So the first use of one of our functions. Well, we're going to use the I, we're going to use the Y, and we're going to use the carryover. And also the carryover, how is the carryover defined? Well, if there are, basically, here we're going to need another function we just defined. If what came before was just 001, right? Then this value, if you think about it, will be just a one, and there's no carryover value from 001, right? So what we need here is actually to check if there is more than just one value being passed over, so that we can define a carryover. And so we need the majority function here. Okay, and it has the same values. These things will be executed in sequence. So first, ZI will be assigned to this value, and then C will be assigned this majority value. Another way of writing it, I don't know if it confuses you if I write it in this Pythonic way, but this is another way of writing it, right? And then we go all through this array, and you know what's interesting is that if we end up with the zeros element, the leftmost one. So if we end up, like, we add this together, let's say, right? Truth and false is true. In addition, right? No carryover. True and true is zero. One carryover. True and the carryover is zero. One carryover. False and false and the carryover is one, and so on and so forth. And then we do this and end up all here. And let's say, I assume, for example, here it ends with TT, right? So if you were to add this up, then there would actually be a carryover. But where does it carry over from? Well, it doesn't carry over to anywhere. So actually, if you want, information is lost there. And this corresponds to the fact that all our output values are always arrays of length 32. So in algebraic terms, this means that we go only up to this number. So how many values are there of this length? Well, 2 to the power of 32. 2 to the power of 32. So this is the amount of different values that fit into this array. And everything beyond that gets cut off, right? It doesn't matter what happens there. So this is actually a mod. Or everything we do here, the arithmetic is basically this mod 2 to the power of 32. And if I remember correctly, this is also, if we go to the hash function. Yeah, so this is addition modulo 2 to the power of 2. So this is the schema which describes what we are going to do. Okay, we can actually go further down. Right. So this is also one, the first note here, right? Okay. So this addition modulo is already built in. This is not addition. This is basically addition mod 2 to the power of 32. But for, you know, for sanity's sake, I will also just copy myself here and override my own stuff. Okay. Okay, and then we need one utility function before we get to the actual hash function. So we're going to write this function, which takes arrays of arrays, like these kind of things, and turns them to hexadecimal values, right? And I was like trying to make it concise, and I actually came up with something pretty here. So we're going to do not x and y, but we're going to do arrays of arrays. I call this arrays. And what does it look like? Well, this is going to be three lines. We're going to return a hexadecimal. So this is a string, and this is a very stupid thing, but in Python, to join a sequence of strings, you have to use this method function, object-oriented style, if you want. There's, I think, no other option. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to take we're going to loop through the arrays, right? The elements of these arrays are again arrays. This is an array of arrays. These things are numbers, as I've argued with this, with the first one there, right? It's, you know, also just as you just saw, right? And we're going to convert all these numbers to decimal numbers. And so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to map them to hexadecimals. And there is this Python formatting way of doing that, and it goes like that. So I'm not super minimalistic here, but you know, we don't have to take it to the top. And in any case, I'm minimalistic in the sense that I use this an inbuilt formatting function. But this is the most boring function of the video anyway. So we're going to use this formatting function, and here, what do we want to format? Well, we are going to loop, as I said, right? We're going to do some for loop, and give me a break. Right. So actually, we have to do it like this. Here, the issue is also that to give the exact return value as the SHA function, we have to make sure that we don't drop leading zeros again, right? So if I'm just naively converting every number to hexadecimal number, then it might be that I'm dropping leading zeros, like zeros before the number, because as numbers, the zeros are don't have value. But for the hash function, we want to have a fixed length, so we need to restore these. And what we do here is there's also an inbuilt function called fill, and we say, you know, we want results of length 8, and these should be these are then automatically filled with trailing zeros. And here we loop through this array, and I am. I don't think I need the I here. In my cheat sheet, I did it. So I will stick with that. I don't think I will make use of this I here, just for notice. I think that was a blunder. Let me actually check. So if I remove this, sorry for the divergence. Yeah. That doesn't need it. Okay. Okay. Sorry. So we're going to loop through these arrays, right? So for r in r's, r's is the input value. Array is a one unique array. And here we already now we can use r here, right? And r is composed of a bunch of bits, so we also have to loop through this r. So we're going to do an enumerate here, because, you know, not only like all these bits, they are just zeros and ones, but they represent something different. Namely, they represent the power of two, right? The rightmost bit just counts as 2 to the power of 0. The second rightmost bit counts 2 to the power of 1, and so on and so forth. So this is just arithmetic. I'm not going to comment much more on that. But what we want is we want to loop through this array, and we want to know the index. So we're going to go with for I and x here. So I is going to the index and x is going to be the value. And we're going to have some numbers here, nums. Make this more concrete in a second. And we're going to sum all these numbers for each digit, and that sum. And this will be our result, right? And what is these numbers? Well, it's 2 to the power of something. Here I will make use of this property of the Python true value, that I can use booleans as zeros and ones. And I will go with true x, like this turns the values to 0 or 1, times 2 to the power of, and then I do the loop from the wrong direction if you want, and so I have to do the same spiel as before by 2 31 minus I, and so this index will start with 0, and so the first value that will be grabbed on the very most right is 2 to the power of 31. Yeah, I hope that makes sense. Yeah, it makes sense. Okay, and so that's that. And, you know, because I was a little bit fuzzy on that, I will also copy myself here. And finally, we're going to the SHA function, finally, right? So brace yourself, it's only like 15 more lines of code. So we're already done with this shit. So we're going to define the SHA function, and it will take an input value. This is going to be the array where we already dumped our message, right? This is the function argument. And so what do we do? So this will be in two blocks. And first we're going to take this W. So if we go back, this has here in the first 40 bits hello, writing hello, and then there's this one, and then there's a whole bunch of zeros, like, you know, about 13 times zero, 13 times 32 zeros, and then is the length of the input message. And what's going to happen now is, instead of this boring W, we're going to make a more odd and interesting one. We're going to step through all these 16 rows of this W, and at each step in our iteration, we're going to take previous values, which are either zeros and ones, and shuffle stuff around and make something fishy out of it, if you want. And so, you know, we're going to pick up some values in one array and dump some combination of values from previous arrays, and then in the next one we're going to pick that up again, and so forth and so forth. So it's going to get messy here already, and this is not even the body of the digest function. So what do we actually do here? Well, so as I said, we're going to have two for loops. Like, this is the W one. Then we're going to set up running variables for the constants. Well, maybe I should show this one again. So what do we want to do here? We're going to set up, we have these constants already, and we're going to have two loops. This is the first loop. This is definition of the constants. This is the second loop. And then there is a kind of, this is also part of the loop. And then there's a kind of closing. And then we concatenate them together, and we also do a transformation into hex. So what's it, this is going to be? Well, I do a pseudocode before I get into it. So I say for I in range, and here is start, like these first 16, they are already established, and then This is actually 64 ones. The first 16 are already filled, and the rest is going to be messed up by us. So we're going to loop from 16s, the 16s ones, to the 64 ones, and then fill, like I read this as a comment, fill up w, and then we're going to define the these constants a, b, c, d, f, g, h. These are going to initialize as h, so they are going to initialize as these 8 numbers. And then there's another for loop. Then there's the main digest loop. So for I in, and then there's another range 64. And then, do the twist. And then finally, I can actually already write that. There's this adding up, right? And so we're going to use our two hex function. And then do, let's say wrap up. And then eventually we're going to print the result. We're going to apply our SHA function that we will write to W. The capital W is the one that I defined above. So this is this W. The small one is just a function variable. Okay. And this is supposed to be a 256 bit array represented as hexadecimal. So how does it look like? Okay, fill up W. So we're going to go through W I, right? And so in short, what we're going to do is we take W on different spots in the array and move the arrays, like the 32 bits arrays around left and right. We use the cut and the rotation function, right? So we kind of shift it, if you want, horizontally. And then we're going to XOR a bunch of values together, which the XOR operation is an okay operation in a sense that it's component wise, so it's not like so brutal. But then we're going to use this XOR value like arrays and apply the add function a bunch of time as well. And so I want to make this case here that the add function is really brutal in the quote-unquote non-linearity sense for Boolean values. Because let's imagine you have, this is the add function, right? Let's imagine you have an array of three values, right? Then so let's say x equals, and there's some generally variables, like let's say u, v, w, and then we have another one which is, s, t, p. This is our these two values. What happens if I add them up? Well, first what happens first? Okay, well, the leftmost, like the return value will be a set. Then these will have three values, and everything on the left is dropped. This value will be XOR, XOR, and the initial value here is false. So this will be WP. Yeah, this is these last values here. Okay, so this will, this may or may not result in one or zero. This might be both ones. So there is a carryover, a potential one, which is a function again of W and P, right? It depends on this. And this is now added in the XOR XOR of the next value. So this is V, T, and that. And the issue now is that, you could take these Boolean values and represent them as some simple polynomials that can only be zeros and ones. Like the variables can only be zeros and ones. The result of the polynomials is also zeros and ones. It's like, again, it helps if you saw the last video. But my point that I'm making is that the value of this thing depends now on all four of these variables. Like everything here depends on everything here, and everything on this last slot here right? This might or might not have a carryover value, and whatever comes out here, like, it will depend on you as, and then the carryover value from here, basically a W, V, and T. So this is basically as a function, as a Boolean function, as a Boolean polynomial, if you want, a function of six variables. And so if you add these numbers together, right, the numbers that you get here, like, it's terrible. Like, it blows up in a nasty way. And so if you would want to keep track of that, then, I mean, you would just run out of space. Like, these functions are hard to crack because you cannot keep track of all these dependencies, right? This is just one addition, and then the result of one addition is an array where the variables, the dependent variables, stack up, and because we're looping over these functions and in each eat loop applying more and more add functions, this, like, the dependencies just go through the roof. And of course, you know, on a ASIC level, on a hardware level, each step is just dealing with a one or a zero. They don't keep track of meta information or like some representation of some variables. They just evaluate zeros and ones. But if you would want to analyze it and, like, go from the output to the input, then we would have to, you know, I mean, there are many techniques, but the naive approach to say, oh, you know, just crack it. It's just a polynomial. Well, just like a Boolean function. Well, it's if you want its own field to, you know, crack propositions. You know, you can view the output of this hash function, especially in the way we designed it here, right, where we just do Boolean logic and have here these Boolean operations. You can view the output of the hash function as a sequence of 256 propositions that depend on the input, like these 60 values, but in some nasty way that is exponentially blowing up. And I don't use the word exponential lightly. Okay. So let's delete this stuff that I just dumped there. Where was it? Here. Okay, so what did I promise? Well, you know, I think I will make it more concise and actually just copy over. You can, like, after the argument I just gave, you can get kind of a hold on what I just discussed. So I will actually just copy it over there and then go through it. So as I said, this WI starts in row with the index 16 or 1 of 15. It starts with the index 16, actually. And then what you do is you say, oh, you know, I 16. Well, let me look back at position index 1. Let me look back at position index 1. Let me look back at position index 14. And take this W, like, this is the 14th array. In this case, since we have such a short input message, the 14th one is actually filled with zeros. Do a write rotation by 17, where this has a length 32, so you can rotate up to 32. Do this a bunch of times, then do an XOR, like, component wise of these arrays, and I'm running out of battery. Give me 1 second, and you can study this beautiful function. God damn it. Microphone check 1, 2. Let's not dwell too much onto it. So this is component wise operations. It's not as bad, but But then we're going to add them up. Like basically we're going to add up 1, 2, 3, 4 values, right? So this is basically, I can show you this on this computer. So this is the right rotation. This is the XOR XOR just in a more primitive way. This is basically what we do with the if clauses. And then we're going to do this for 1, 2, 3, 4 additions. So 1, 2, 3, am I in the wrong row? Yes, I was in the right wrong row. But there's also right rotations and they use only XOR, right? So this implementation here uses, what it doesn't use here is the majority function, right? So this, these are just representations of other Boolean functions that we have already defined, but it returns in, results in the same value. Nevertheless, it's good that we see that now both columns, oh, I'm losing my voice. Both columns are very similar in that you do right rotation, you do some Boolean operations on them, and then you add them up. In this case, for the W, it's only quotes and quotes, three additions. And then, so we see this, you know, right rotate 7 and so on and so forth. Gets added up, and so what you have in the end is that the rows from 16 to 64 already, like, they get information from the initial input already squeezed in, but their complexity already starts to grow up. And for example, so if you are in line, let's say you're in a loop in line 20, then this will pick up something from line 5 and write something to it, and two rows later, the line number 20, to which you just wrote something which depends on the original message, will also get picked up and be weaved into this W. So the last W is like even more like, not just the addition of these arrays, but actually row by row, things get merged together. And then, okay, then we initialize these working variables. And then it gets even worse in a sense. We have one addition more. We mix in all these values in the first, like for j equals 0, the first index. This is just these constants, right? So here's the constant. These are all just constant. We have some Boolean functions, if function, and so on. And we have XORs and right rotate. And in any case, the global constants k. Get thrown into the mix. So these k's are all these numbers, right? And they bring a certain randomness because you cannot really counter. You cannot really, like, you might want to attempt to zero out some values and find holes in the hash function by finding spots inside the algorithm where values get made, you know, non-inferential. But there are some extra randomness thrown in, so you know, you have to, it gets tricky. It's not like some, it makes the if you want, the Boolean polynomial have quote unquote random coefficients. And so you do that in each row, you evaluate this ugly thing, and then these variables get reassigned, they get reassigned new values, and these values depend, like two in each column, two of them depend also on this temp function, on this value, right? And so this thing has W into it. So now all these constants also have via this operation the W into it. So all these start to depend on the input message as well, right? If you don't look like the squeezed Python look here, we can take a look at this here. So now this is the digest or compression function main loop. Again, we start with constants. Okay, that's the first thing is okay. Then W gets into the mix, defines temp 1. But then temp 1 gets also into these variables. So these depend on W, and so by this already blown up version of our input message. And then this is just one of the loops. And then, you know, get to the second loop and suddenly this E, which already now depends on the input value, gets right rotated and so on and so forth and added eventually to the second row. And so all rows get in. And so the hard thing about these rows are being added, like all of these 64 rows being added in each iteration of the loop, also mean that even if you manage somehow to manipulate the input of the hash function to get to some sort of structure in the bulk of the iterations and of this loop, in the end you will always get the last W, which by this part, right, but this Buller part depends heavily on all of the rest of this of the input values, right? So in the last bit, it's the worst W row, if you want. And then all these lines run through. You have everything heavily digested, and then you do a final add up with the whatever the variables are. Then by now with this constant H. So this is thrown again into the ring again, last time. So it was thrown here and let's get it added here. But this last row just adds constant because H is fundamentally a constant. This is not an interesting row. You get one last addition. And then we're done. Then we turn everything to a hex value output and print it. So let's see if I copy pasted everything correctly. I am already exited. So let's go with Python SHA-2-life. No, of course not. Line 112. Yeah, that's one I copy pasted though. Okay, maybe. Yes, okay, so the hello maps to this thing. If you want to see how that looks like a little bit under the hood, I can add more print statements. So what do we have here? Let me try one thing. This is the result. Result is a list given by this thing. Okay, still works. What we could actually do is, what would be interesting, we could loop through this thing. We can say for array in result print array. Of course, yeah, this since I use these values, right, type theory is live. The whole computation is with these Boolean values, right? So let's make something nice out of that. Here we go with, or nice, I mean, whatever you consider nice, but let's go with just these conventional values, right? So here we see, if I am not confused, the output as, that doesn't even fit into this screen, the output as the array as it actually computed, right? So obviously, I never broke out of this format of 32 size arrays. So everything is always operated on these 32 size arrays. And just before I translate these things to these arrays, these 8 arrays to hex, it looks like that. So this is basically this before it gets translated to hex. And so that would be the first eighth of this thing. And so, okay. Oh, well, I know my videos are always very long, but this way, at least I can get in some detail. thanks for watching. I already have another video in mind. I think I will get a little bit more back to my physics roots, and we'll talk about a topic which is not interesting just to physics but also to financial markets, namely stochastic differential equations. So subscribe to this video if you made it through this 1 hour 40 minutes video, and and reach out if you have any questions. Take care.